Hello, everyone. This is Sukti 14 class. Sociology of Religion. My name is D.O.Q. Michael Chika, and I will be your facilitator for this course. In this course, we will introduce you to the basic ideas and methods with which sociologists analyze the relationship between religion and society. In this course, we will also explore what it means to think about religious language, symbols, belief system, and practices as a social phenomenon. You know, to be very clear on what we're about to embark on, you know, for sociologists, religion is not something purely spiritual. What we are saying in essence here is that religion is a product of social interactions. So, in this course, it will help students to develop a sociologically informed argument about issues and problems surrounding religion, particularly in our contemporary and modern society. Okay? Here are the course aim. So, after successfully completing this course, it is expected that the students should be able to reflect on the aims and perspectives of sociology of religion as an academic field of study. Understand the basic issues and concepts in sociology of religion, then appreciate how the major paradigm view religion, talking about the various models or theories in sociology, I mean the three models of theories of sociology view religion, and then you should be able to adapt a well-informed argument about religion as a social phenomenon. Also, after the self-completion of this course, the students should be able to appreciate the role of religion in politics and development, particularly in the Nigerian society. So, in order to effectively achieve the aim set, the course set its overall objectives, which are always stated at the beginning of each section. So, always read these objectives so that you can check your progress. The course has been structured into 5 study sections. So the first section deal with the subject matter of sociology of religion. While the second section deal with the classical work in sociology of religion. The third looks at the theoretical perspective of religion. While the fourth look at religious organization. And finally, but not the least, the fifth section looks at the religious behavior. Our study section 1. The subject matter of sociology of religion. At the end of this section, the student should be able to 1. At least state the meaning of sociology, define religion, provide us with the definition of all what the subject matter of sociology of religion is all about, give us the basic elements of religion, state the forms of religion, and finally state or tell us the functions of religion. Meaning of sociology. As a social science discipline, sociology is a scientific study of group. Tracing its origin to Paris at the turn of the 19th century, after the bourgeoisie revolution. When we say sociology is a scientific study of group, we are saying that it's not just the group, you know, sociology is a scientific study of group. Group range in size, from diet, small, medium, to big. So the focus of sociology is to study group, like small group like you and your partner, your family, or the religious group that you belong to, you know, these are group or society, like large size group like society. You can talk about Nigeria as a society or as a group. So it is the focus of sociology to understand the group patterns, the behaviors of this group, their characteristics in terms of their culture, stratification, and all that. So it's an important subject to understand group in a scientific way, because we spend most of our entire life in a group. You know, think about the number of groups you belong to, your family, where you work, a group of friends, or maybe the sports team that you participate on, or the rangers group you belong. So you're going to realize that we spend our entire life in group. So, and sociologists, for us, we try to investigate the structure of these groups, organizations, the societies, how they interact, and the culture, the ways they behave, and all that. These are basically the foci of sociologists.
Look, he study group characteristics and the pattern as well. What is religion? Two basic questions from time immemorial, you know, has actually been humans have concerns to search for these two basic questions: why do we live, why do we die, and all that. And then over the years, again, society have struggled with the need to give meaning to human existence and to provide people with the motivation for survival. So according to my doctrine, all society have attempted to satisfy this need, you know, by making distinctions between the sacred and the profane. Alright? So it's on this note that my doctrine defines religion as a unified system of belief and practices that's usually related to sacred things. Okay? He further say that religion happens in society when there is separation between the profane, what is seen as the ordinary life, and then the sacred, thing that are seen as to be very holy, you know, and more of supernatural thing. You know. But in subsequent session, we'll be able to see the meaning of this thing directly, profane and sacred. Okay, so religion again can be seen as a system of rules and norms that is organized around a sacred realm and that bind people together in a social group or in group setting. Okay, take for example, you know, in the case of the sacred and the profane. You know, if you look at cows, cow is something that is very sacred in India, among the people of India, but it's actually not sacred in another country. So church waivers, example like cross and Bible, you know, the Catholic see cross as a sacred thing to them, but not for some non-Catholics, you know. So what is sacred in another society or group might not necessarily be sacred, and then vice versa. Alright, so sociologists basically are not concerned with the truth or otherwise of any religion. So rather they focus on the social characteristics of religion and the consequence that religion has for society. That's the looking at the implication of religious institution to the society or to the group that you find yourself. But what then is the definition of the subject matter, or what actually is the sociology of religion? As I've noted earlier, I've said that sociology is a social science discipline, you know, that takes the group as its object of study. All right. And we have traced it to its origin to Paris, following the bloody revolution that enveloped both the bourgeois revolution, industrial revolution that characterized Europe in the 19th century. So we are saying that since then sociology has emerged, and then sociology has since then concerned itself with analysis of social issues in society. So, and issues such as crime, crisis, culture, conflict, change, and development. So, but over the years, you realize that sociology, or general sociology, cannot really address all these issues at the same time. So, it becomes important or imperative on the part of sociology to fragment itself, you know, by developing branches that will focus on the analysis of specific issues in the society. So, this actually explains the reason for the emergence of sociology of religion within the general sociology, and of course other branches of sociology. So sociology of religion actually is another branch of sociology, and then sociologists in this field try to study the belief, practices, and organizational form of religion using the tools and method of the discipline of sociology. So put differently, we are saying that sociology of religion is another field within the general field of sociology that employs sociological insights, that employs sociological method in its analysis of what belief and practices or organizational form of religion. Okay, so it's a subfield within the general realm of sociology in which sociology evaluates the social crisis of religion, the consequences that it has for the society. So we'll move to our next aim, which is to understand the basic elements of religion. So there are basically five of them. The first being the sacred, the profane, the ritual, system of religious belief, and finally organization of believers. So the sacred, which of course one of the basic elements of religion, is there must be presence of the sacred. And there are those aspects of our life that are extraordinary or supernatural. In other words, holy. So for us or the religious, in this regard, what is sacred is seems to be something that is not ordinary. There is a special, you know, attachment to it, and it is seen to be having supernatural, you know, power and all that. So the sacred is anything that is considered to be part of the spiritual world. In most cases, it inspires us, and then it commands respect and reverence. All right. And then, on the other hand, profane, of course, is more or less a direct opposite of the sacred, because it's anything that is considered to be part of the ordinary world, and thus it's very, very familiar. There is no reverence attached or respect being attached. It's just seen as a part of the normal world, things in the world. We have as the next, the third basic element of religion to be ritual. Of course, a ritual has to do with a set of actions often believed to have symbolic value as prescribed by religion, and it must be performed or usually performed at a regular interval for the purpose of reinforcing belief, tradition, and practices among the members of such religion. And they are regularly repeated carefully as prescribed, you know, so because it symbolizes the behavior or the symbolizes the cherished value and belief system of such religion. Then we have system of religious belief. Of course, it has to do with the doctrine that defines a group as into a basic question of life, as the doctrine of a particular religion. It could be Christianity, it could be Muslim, it could be the traditional religion as we have in Africa and all that. So sets of religious belief has to do with those doctrines that define the group asset. The next is organization of believers. Of course, there should be usually a group of people who gather from time to time and share the same religious belief. So what it means here, there must be organization of believers, those who share in that same faith. Forms of religion. There are basically five major forms of religion which can be categorized in different ways according to specific characteristics of faith and how religious groups are organized. One is supernaturalism, second is animism, third is theism, fourth polytheism, and fifth monotheism. For the supernaturalism, it has to do with the belief that supernatural forces affect people's life, either positively or negatively. So it is a form of religion where there is no distinction, you know, between sense of experience and the supernatural. So this also means that all natural phenomena are part of a single force. For instance, if you look at the Eskimos, they believe in greater force, but they have no clear concept of God or the rituals involving. So, but they do not participate in what they believe in. So when people who are more reserved, they understand there is an existence of a supernatural power, you know, but they actually don't believe. They live more or less a free life or kind of free thinker. Then the second is animism. Of course, this is the belief that plants or animals or other elements of the natural world are endowed with spiritual life forces having an impact on events in the society. This is very common among our African society and of course some American cultures. So it is common for us to see people who are worshipping, you know, Amadi or her, you know, or worshipping a python, like in the case on society, some Igbos in Anambra and all that. So generally the belief or have that some plant or animal have supernatural forces that can impact the life of such group or society, you know. So this is referred to animism. Of course, the next is theism. And this theism is a form of religion in which God God are considered as separate from human and from other living things on earth, and of course are basically divided into two: polytheism and monotheism. Polytheism are those who believe in several gods. Of course, it's a form of theism which there are numerous gods, all of whom occupy themselves with some of the universe of all and of human life. So examples, you can talk about the ancient Greek gods and Romans, and even in some of African society too. You know, in the case of the Igbo society, talk about Amadi Oha, that is the god of thunder. So several gods, you know, they live in the existence of these several gods and all that. The monotheism, of course, is the direct opposite of that polytheism. You know, this kind of religion believe in a single all-powerful God, who determine how human fate and destiny can be addressed through prayers and all that. So, of course, Islam and Christianity are the most popular monotheistic religion across the world. Then, abstract ideas as one of the forms of religion. This is a form of religion that centers on abstract ideas of spiritual and human behavior. And then, it's commonly among the society of the Far East. And are basically categorized into two. So you can talk about Buddhism and Confucianism. Buddhism, for the Buddhists, they recognize no god of judgment. So each daily action as having spiritual consequences. And they also believe in reincarnation. For the Buddhists, they also has its origin in one person called Siddhartha Gautama, described as the founder of Buddhist. So the Buddhists believe that much of life seen in this world involves suffering. Therefore, the solution is not found in worldly wealth and power, but the use of meditation to move beyond selfish concern and material desires. Okay? So, the Confucius was also the founder of this form of religion, in which he urged followers to engage the world according to, you know, a moral code of conduct. All right. So the central idea of Confucianism is humaneness. Humaneness. That's the central idea. So this means that we must always place moral principle above our own self-interest, looking for tradition for guidance on how to live their lives. So, it has been argued that of all over the world religion, Confucianism stands out as lacking in clear term sense of the sacred. Yeah, because we cannot really place any sacred thing to say, okay, this is where they make reverence to. Alright, so they basically lack it. Functions of religion. One of the major functions of religion is social cohesion. Religion strengthens the bonds among people. When you are participating in religious ceremony, sharing belief, it creates sense of belonging, which can make people feel less alone. So, religion is a source of social solidarity. You know, in fact, from the work of M.I. Durkheim, after the study of suicide, you know, one of the founding fathers of sociology, he discovered that the rate of suicide, we are lower among people with strong attachment to religious group. So, because of you are going to church, they preach to you about the need of preservation of life, and every time you go to church, you are being motivated. You see people who are sharing the same faith with you. There is this social bond, you know, attachment that is just more than when you are not in a group of these people. So, if you are in a group of your sport team, or another, there is this particular social of attachment that religious bond people. So, that's why sociologists conclude that religion stretching bond among people. Alright. However, for some sociologists, especially those who are in the conflict theory, they have suggested that it doesn't create cohesion, but rather the religion actually divides people. You know, and you can look at the cases of Arabs and Israelis, Muslims and Hindus. So especially when there is two, you know, pronounced group of religion in a particular society, then in most cases, for conflict theory, they say it breeds actually conflict, it doesn't bring cohesion. So, but when we get to our perspective, so you see more of this argument very clearer. Another function of religion is social control. Of course, religions serve as an agent of social control, you know, by encouraging conformity to norms. A religious fellow who believes in the sacredness of the Bible, the Torah, and the Quran as a means of giving people social conformity. So you see each religion having their rules or commandments as given to them by their God. And most of these things are geared towards social control. They are geared towards controlling people against deviant behavior. Of course, another one is emotional support. Religion also provides emotional support for the people during difficult times. Religion helps people endure disappointment and suffering by providing comfort in believing that harsh circumstances have a special purpose. Like we heard some popular Bible verses where they say you should suffer today to enjoy your heaven. You know, blessed are the poor in heart and all that. So these preachings, you know, gives emotional support, especially during difficult times. But it has been argued that those who went to go to church or looking for answers to the unforeseen is because they needed emotional support or they're having issues. So they have to run to church or to the religious group to get this emotional support. Alright. Religious also attempt to provide answers to the ultimate question of concerning life and death. You know, so the argument that is heaven and hell. So they try to provide answers to that, which is one of the ultimate questions of life. You know, when would die, where are we going to? Most religions told us that we are going to heaven when you behave fine, when you worship the living God, and if you didn't do, you are going to hell. So religions make an attempt to provide answers to these things. And then these answers, you know, they lend strength and calm to people as they approach the unknown and the expected. So, okay, of course, like conflict sociologists, they always argue that emotional support lent by religious actually sometimes block our political change. So, but religion actually encourage people to accept their social condition because the world are with them in this spiritual life. These are other, you know, functions of religion that you can look at. Religion promises hope to all those who are facing one stressful event or another, you know, particularly during the time of natural disaster and all that. You can see how they make them accept the situation, that it is not their own will, that it is God's willing and all that. So generally, religion serves as a spiritual comforter to the people that are going through, you know, distressful situations. It has a furnishing psychological diversion, you know, from the unwanted life situation. And it also sustains existing social structure. So, for religion help because of it helps to maintain chain of authority. It helps to sustain the existing social structure. So, it helps to maintain stability in the society. And of course, it's as an instrument of socialization too, particularly for the young ones into the society. Thank you very much.